The evolution of the role of men in media has been an interesting one to watch. And while in the 60s, it was characters like Ward Cleaver that led the way when it came to what people expected a man to be, many will say that has changed, maybe for the worst. Take a look at this. From Homer Simpson to Phil Dunphy.
I've always said that if my son thinks of me as one of his idiot friends, then I've succeeded as a dad.
Hey, Dad, think fast.
Media has depicted men as either bumbling idiots who stumble their way through life, angry take the law into our own hands maniacs.
If the world had only one throat.
The confident guy.
Hey, Jimmy.
Kristen.
Hey, babe.
Get ready for the wildlife.
Girls.
Or wimpy nerds.
I'm sorry, but this is important.
What is it?
Back to the Future 2 was in the Back to the Future 3 case. And Back to the Future 3 was, get this, in the Back to the Future 2 case.
And then we can't forget the men who seem to only have one thing on their minds when it comes to the opposite sex. Is that really how women see men? Or more importantly, is this how men see themselves? According to the Pew Research Center, an increasing amount of men have become more intensely involved in their children's lives, spending more time with them. And 41% of men say they worry about what people will say about their appearance. So, does the media have it wrong? It's a good question, right?
It's a great question, yeah.
Well, joining us to chat a little bit more about this question and men and the role of men in media is Paul LaFrance, an HGTV host, and Andrew Blackwood, a life coach. Welcome, guys.
Thanks for having us on.
It's a good conversation to have. I'm so excited to have this conversation.
It is a good conversation.
And I'm kind of the woman to kind of really guys in. Is that why I'm here, really?
Yeah.
Well, you understand men.
Of course. So well.
We'll behave. We promise.
So when we're talking about men in media, do you feel that media has it right when it comes to how they portray men?
I mean, the reality is there's so many men and so many different experiences of manhood. So I don't see how they could get it right. So they try to pigeonhole people into several categories, which a lot of men don't fit into and don't want to fit into.
Yeah. How about you, Paul?
I have a lot of opinions on this subject.
You are a man in media right now.
I'm a man in media, and I'm telling you, from an overall scope, I truly believe that men have never been more confused in the history and all throughout time than they are right now in this culture. I mean, are we supposed to have emotions? Are we not supposed to have emotions? Are we supposed to be ultra masculine? Are we supposed to be more feminine? Are we allowed to cry? Are we not allowed to cry? I have four daughters, so I think maybe I have the benefit of being, you know, I'm swimming in a sea of estrogen all the time.
Right.
So I think that's been good for me. But I tell you, I look around and I see so many men confused, and the image of men in media right now does not help.
You know, this conversation, Carrie, spurned out of conversations I was having with some coworkers, especially Cheryl Weber, and we were just talking about just how confusing it must be for women and men. And I was especially thinking about single men as well.
Yeah.
Because I think, you know, as you're out there in the dating world and you're trying to figure out, you know, do I hold the door open for her or don't I? And you see what media is portraying, that just creates more confusion.
Yeah, it does. The whole thing even about, you know, who pays on a date. It's been a long time since I've dated, over a quarter century.
Yeah.
I've been married 25 years.
Yeah.
But, you know, where does chivalry fit today? It's a great question. So, Paul, it's interesting to be on the same panel with you. Because when I got married, you know, I grew up, my dad, tool and mold maker, but worked really well with his hands, was apprentice of the year for 5 years when he was younger, but like never did anything around the house. That was always, we had people in.
That's
for
like
that.
Me.
You too? Really?
I don't have time.
So my wife's father fixed everything himself, has never hired anything out. So when we got married, she's like, can you hang some picture frames? And I'm like, I don't know really how to drive a nail. I don't. And I wish that was an exaggeration, but it's not really. And she kind of looked at me and it's like, what did I marry? And I'm like, well, surprise, surprise, you know. And so I've gotten a few skills here and there, but like, you know, is that something you're supposed to do as a guy? Is that not? Are you less of a man if you don't know,
and
you know, how to work with power tools?
And even that question, are you supposed to do that as a man? I think is a good question to ask.
What do you think, Andrew?
You know, I think the reality is you talked about skill building.
Yeah.
And when I meet with people, it's all about skill building, whether they're learning how to drive a nail or learning how to label their emotions. it's an opportunity. Although men are confused, it's a perfect opportunity for other men to kind of step forward and say, this is the definition, this is the working definition, this is a good example to follow.
But do you feel as less than a man if you can't do these things?
Okay, so let's take living in Canada, for instance.
Yeah.
You're born in Canada as a man, you're supposed to automatically know how to play hockey.
Yeah, and build for me.
And build a deck.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's like a pastime. And you're supposed to be able to hunt beaver as a moose
right.
as well.
You of know? Course.
Automatically, it's just supposed to be naturally a part of your identity as a man. And if you don't know how to do those kind of culturally acceptable masculine things, then you're sitting there looking in the mirror going, well, am I a man? I don't know. I honestly don't know looking in the mirror. I'm confused.
Yeah.
You know, I have so many very close friends around me that are not, like, if they lifted a hammer, that people would just run out of the room screaming, not knowing what kind of dangerous thing could happen. It is confusing. What if you're a sensitive guy? What if you're a guy that like, I'm a guy who swings hammers and cries at Disney movies, and I'm not afraid to admit it. And when I do admit it, I find that other guys go, oh, is it okay to admit that? Because I thought I would be in some serious trouble with my peers if I
right.
did.
Yeah.
Right.
That's hard.
Go ahead, Andrew.
No, and I was just gonna say that's the exact kind of opportunities that we have to help men realize you have all that you need to be the best version of you, whether that's swinging a hammer or crying at a movie.
Yeah.
It's all appropriate depending on the context, right?
And I guess it's understanding then who you are. Let's
Precisely.
Translate this now. Let's put this on to the church. Because I remember once talking to somebody and they said, you know, my husband just doesn't want to come to church anymore because he doesn't resonate with some of the music that's being sung. He doesn't resonate with the, you know, the feminine way that some of our worship music is written. You were talking...
Jesus,
the lover of my soul.
It's like, whoa, that's weird, man. What do you mean?
Right. Yeah. So how do men then, you know, you're speaking for all men in all eternity.
Right. Which you can.
Which no pressure.
Can.
No pressure.
But how do you then translate that to your faith and what that looks like?
Wow, how much time do you have?
I know.
My opinion would be, I read a book called, one of my favorite books is The Tale of Three Kings.
Mm. And, oh, it's a great book.
And I love the beginning of that book because it said, you know, this young man later on in life, or seeks out one of David's mighty men later on in life, and you know, runs in and says, oh my goodness, what was it like to be one of David's mighty men? And the guy's like, we were basically a bunch of misfits and outcasts who followed around a guy who cried all the time.
Yeah.
You know, this is King David, this is the man, the great king, you know, he was just a mess, you know.
Yeah.
And I love that. I love that part of that story because it just said, yes, we have got to remove our masks as men. I mean, people in general, but particularly men. Men have very thick masks because we believe we're supposed to wear them. And I believe that the absolute opposite is true. In the church, the more authentic and real you are, the less you are pretending in any way, shape, or form, the more impact you're going to have on people. I know that's true.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I'm a pastor of a church, Connexus Church, and I've been doing this for 20 years now. And, you know, I realized early on there has been a feminization in the church. 70% women, 30% men. And frankly, I think that's two things, boredom and irrelevance. Like,
right.
You know, honestly, most 40 minutes, how many sermons have you sat through 40 minutes at a time and you're like, I have no idea what was just said. Like, sometimes I've given those, and like, there's no excuse for that. You've got to be relevant, you got to be real, and then we actually program our services, music and everything, targeted at the 30-year-old guy. Hi. We don't always hit it, because our theory is, if you get the guy, he will bring his family. And I think that is an implication in the next generation, because we often find, if it's just the mom who attends, and listen, we are grateful for moms who attend, often you lose the kids once they hit 12 or 13.
Yeah.
And so we're trying to engage men at every level. And I think many, many women are grateful for that.
How do you get the guy? How do you connect with that guy?
It's really interesting because I've noticed the shift we're talking about in terms of church and how people relate to church. And the emphasis has really been about relationship with Jesus Christ, which is all about intimacy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And in order to be intimate, you need to be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And that's where the challenge is, helping men to be vulnerable, whether you're at church or whether to be, because we don't think vulnerability is strength.
That's right.
But it is.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Weakness and meekness are like intertwined because they just sound alike.
Yeah,
but
right.
Meanwhile, they're two completely different meanings.
Right.
And I think the minute you talk about intimacy with Christ, most men have no idea how to relate to that.
Right.
They have no idea how to connect with that. And, you know, my opinion is, like, I was one of those guys sitting, you know, asked me to sit through a 40-minute sermon where if there was any level of anything that was less than authentic, I'd be like,
absolutely.
Right. Right.
Totally agree.
And I'm the first to admit it. And you can look out into any particular church congregation and you can see those guys. And you know what I've found to be the number one way to connect with them? You surprise the living daylights out of them by saying something completely and totally vulnerable about what you're struggling with, but what you're dealing with in your life that you know they're dealing with as well. I mean, my goodness, you want to get up on the stage and talk about, say, men's struggles with pornography.
Yeah.
You will have everyone's attention. Every man will be like, they will all get
right,
up and,
right.
and look around because they are not used to that type of thing being so outwardly spoken.
Right.
And then the men will look around the room and go, is anyone going to respond? And all it takes is one man one person to be vulnerable first, one man to respond, and the rest of the men go, wow, are we okay? Are we allowed to actually speak our real true feelings
right.
in a culture where we don't feel like we're allowed? Then you're onto something.
Because couldn't agree more.
Moment,
you know
right?
what? Oh. We've spent a lot of years trying to do cool church, and what we say around our church now is authenticity is the new cool. If you can just crack it open and talk about what you struggle with, you're in.
Because it takes great strength to be authentic.
It does.
And vulnerable, right?
Thank you so much, guys. We could talk forever.
We could.
Yeah, we could.
On this topic. We have just cracked it open, and thank you so much.
Let's do a 37-part series.
We should. Part one.
Are you a pastor?
Thanks again, guys.